Today, we're going to take a look at the Artillery X1. You might have seen a review or two of this printer on other channels from a couple of months ago, but this is the newest iteration, the V3. From what I've seen, the X1 supposedly has always been a printer that was really close to being a perfect low-budget machine and only had a couple of flaws that would need to be figured out. So what I really want to know is if Artillery or Evnovo finally managed to push it over the edge and turn it into a great printer, or if they're keeping it as another mediocre CR10-inspired lookalike. Alright, so I'm going to be doing 3D printer reviews all throughout November, and I'll try to cover the ones that, you know, you might be looking into for getting as a Christmas gift or just for yourself. And I'll try to make these videos a bit shorter, not that I'm succeeding with it, but I'm sure there will still be plenty of reviews to watch from me and from everyone else. And of course, I won't be giving you the lovey-dovey sugar-coated version. If you want that, just, you know, have a look at the manufacturer's website or at one of the many reviews that just tried to get you to buy the printer through an affiliate link. We're not doing that today. So let's get cracking on the Artillery X1, starting with the specs. We've got a 300 by 300 by 400 millimeter build envelope with a standard V-slot frame. The hotend and extruder are a direct drive E3D Titan Aero Volcano knockoff with a sock. The bed is a coated glass sheet with a mains powered silicone heater, and it does not have auto bed leveling, but comes with a touchscreen and a filament runout sensor up here. What's unique about the X1 are these flat flex cables that are used on the Z-axis and on the X-axis. That all comes down to a price of $430. What sort of a print quality does that get you? I'm gonna call this really decent. There's a bit more curling visible than I'd like, and on prints where you can see it, it looks like either the filament pulling up on the tool head, the motion system having some inaccuracy, or the spool mount up here wobbling the entire frame is still causing some minor layer imperfections. Overall though, this level of quality is very respectable. And other than for this part where the spaghetti detective actually crashed Octoprint and stopped the print like that, this printer has actually been very reliable for me. And you know, that is something you really need for a printer this size. If this one has an oopsie, it can mean days of printing lost instead of just a couple of hours on a smaller machine. As far as the user experience goes, that's okay too. The included manual is detailed, the initial assembly is fast and relatively easy to do, and they're even reminding you to adjust the V wheels on every axis. The alignment of those is notoriously bad on pretty much every machine that uses them, and when you try to use the printer as it's shipped with loose wheels, these are tightened now, you're not going to have a great time. For software, Artillery are providing Repeteer Host with profiles for Slick3R. If you're not familiar, Repeteer Host is a really weird thing. It's made by a German company, and basically it's another UI on top of your slicer. So it provides a consistent top-level UI and then passes the actual slicing to Slick3R, Prusa Slicer, Cura, etc. I find that way of working super inefficient, since you still have to jump into the slicer itself to change any settings, but you're like not actually supposed to then use the slicer directly, but instead do your object alignment and G-code saving through Repeteer Host. Maybe it makes sense if you also use the Repeteer server, print server, but as is, I would prefer to use any other UI instead of the Repeteer Host one. And because they're using the old Slick3R instead of the optimized Prusa slicer, the slicing itself can be excruciatingly slow at times too. For this vase, I think it took like 15 or 20 minutes just to slice versus seconds when using the same setup on Prusa slicer or a modern version of Cura. The X1 comes with two profiles, PLA Normal and PLA Fine, and they're actually well-tuned and work great with the X1 hardware. There's no profiles for PETG or any other materials included, and with this improved hotend, the printer caps out at around 240 or at most 250 degrees Celsius before the PTFE starts to get damaged. So let's have a bit of a closer look at the components used here, and let's stick with the extruder and the hotend. It's a budget Titan Aero Volcano clone, and instead of using the characteristic single piece front plate and heatsink, it's these two parts that are just screwed together dry, which works, I guess, at least with the Teflon lined heat break that they're using. Those are less reliant on proper cooling anyways, but without the air guide structure that the original Aero uses, this version still spills air all over your printed part, which is another factor that will make printing ABS, ASA, or maybe even PETG somewhat unpredictable on this printer. The hopped gear in here is not particularly sharp, and I do expect that to be a limiting factor if you try to push the printer a bit faster than it is printing now. As is, with the stock 0.4mm nozzle, this extruder isn't working all that hard. Two parts on the extruder that seem a bit off to me. The idler lever, which seems to be a problem for a lot of people out there, hasn't been an issue for me, but the filament guide between the hopped gear and the heat break is. On the original Titan, these are made from palm, so that filament doesn't stick to it as you pull it out of the hot end. On the X1, it looks like it's ABS, and I did have this clog up solidly once when trying to unload filament. This thing actually takes a long time to take apart and fully reassemble. One more thing that whoever is making this Titan Aero knockoff has also messed up is the tension adjustment. Not only is the adjustment screw just kind of hard to use with the way the extruder is mounted on the X1, but the extruder body also doesn't have the little hole where you can see what your idler tension is set to. So adjusting it on the X1 is a bit of a gamble anyways. Between the change in material for the filament guide, the downgraded hob gear, and the rest of it, it seems like this is another one of those cases where a cloner will try to replicate a part, but make little changes that don't seem like a big deal to them because they don't know how the part actually works. But in reality, those changes do make quite a difference. Overall, it's still an average usable setup, but it's just that there's no point in this being an E3D knockoff when you don't get most of the benefits of the original. Hey, by the way, are you subscribed? We're going to see a lot more of weird and unoriginal designs in the coming weeks. Click that button, where is it? Down there, I think. Or you will never know which ones those are. Okay, I also wish the Volcano on here was using a larger nozzle than the 0.4mm one out of the box, because as is, the printer can't move fast enough with its, large and heavy glass bed and relatively heavy tool head to make use of the Volcano's increased melt rate. Prints still take a long, long time to finish if you actually use this printer to make large parts as intended. The printer has 400mm of usable print height, but when even using just 1.5% of that available height and printing a plate like this that's 6mm tall, and using the faster slicing profile, you're already looking at a 10-hour print time. A 0.6 or 0.8mm nozzle would really help this printer along. Before I jump into the electrical and electronics, which are a pain point for this printer, let's quickly stick with the heated components, the heated bed where prints should stick to, and that does work well. It's got this, screen printed surface on the glass, which works great for PLA. It sticks well during prints and releases easily afterwards. It does leave a bit of a texture, but that's fine. But there is a massive problem with the way that the bed is built, and that's that it is incredibly unevenly heated, which is actually not all that uncommon for beds that just use a glass sheet and a silicone heater mat stuck on the bottom. With this one, the spots in the corners where the adjustment screws are located are significantly colder, so any warp happy prints that extend into those areas might give you some trouble sticking down. Really, the fully usable area is about the size as on better printers one size class down. Alright, so while everything up until this point is fine, I guess, the electrical issues for me are an absolute deal breaker because they're not something the average user will be able to fix or even recognize. But they're also a ticking time bomb that could quite literally set your house on fire at any given time. I'm not talking about the flat flex cables that have been an issue for people in the past. They work perfectly fine on my machine and I'm not seeing any hotspots in the connectors that would degrade them over time. What I'm talking about is the 230 volt mains powered components in here. This printer uses a 230 volt heated bed, which, if done correctly, I think is a great addition because they are able to get up to temperature really fast. Couple issues with this one. When I unboxed the Artillery X1, the 230 volt heater, actually, I think back here where the wire connects, was already starting to come loose from the glass on this corner back here. If you would use the printer like that, or if this ever comes loose again during a print, that corner is going to burn up quicker than you can say fire extinguisher. Next, the way that the heater's wiring is routed from the base of the printer to the moving bed. It uses this sort of, you know, coated, semi-rigid sleeving, but instead of rolling smoothly, it kinks in 1, 2, 3 distinct spots. That is going to put a ton of stress on the wires, and they will break eventually. In fact, you can already see some, you know, wear on the sleeving right here. Of course, if you want to know how to set up an electrical fire, this is it. This thing is the reason why I do not want to use this printer, especially not unattended. Now, what's interesting is that it looks like the X1 at some point used a different type of sleeving, and you can actually see it in some of the YouTube videos on their channel. But the fact that they apparently downgraded this, or it didn't properly validate it for use, I don't know, that just doesn't sit right with me. If we look at the electronics, it's an 8-bit MKS Gen L mainboard coupled with a 32-bit controller for the touchscreen. The mainboard runs Marlin 1.1.9, which has all the safety features enabled as far as I can tell. But again, the wiring and all of this, even though it's not safety critical now, is still quite bad. There's mismatched connectors all over the place, locking plug into non-locking sockets, single DuPont-style female connectors into headers with pins that I know are too short to make proper contact, and it's all held together with hot glue. Spicy detail about the AC wiring back here, this pin down here is exposed live voltage. Of course, this is normally all covered up in the bottom compartment. Considering that the frame of the printer is not properly grounded as well, it does become a rather juicy detail. I think the nail in the electrical coffin is the lack of CE, which should be obvious considering all these flaws. This printer and its power supply do have the China export logo actually back here, but not the CE logo that would certify that this machine is built to European safety standards and is legal to import into and sell inside the European Union. It's also lacking the paperwork that would need to be included with the machine if it were to comply with CE. So if you order this from outside the EU and ship it inside the EU, it might actually get confiscated by customs. Yes, there is a CE conformity certificate that you can download that apparently applies to the X1. But when you just Google the issue, the Shenzhen HX company, you find expired permits they're showing off on the website, as well as a blacklist entry on the TÜV website, because apparently Shenzhen HX is involved with forging TÜV testing reports for face masks. I could keep on going here. Like, the touchscreen, it's all right, but it's one of the worst translated and hastily thrown together interfaces on a printer these days. And even though the print quality over here and functionality as a 3D printer is fine, as soon as you look under the hood, it becomes a rather scary machine to use. Artillery or Evnovo have fixed issues on the X1 models before, and I really hope they fix the rest of them too. But until they do, this is a printer that I'm gonna have to advise you to stay away from unless you know what you're doing and are really committed to fixing its flaws. But you know what you shouldn't stay away from? Today's sponsor, Skillshare. Are you looking to get a head start into learning something new, or simply looking for something useful to do with your newfound time? Well, Skillshare is an online learning community, so when you want to start working on a new skill, you've got a huge number of classes to guide you through that learning process. And they do use the learning by doing principle, where you actually get to apply your skill right away. You can take their classes at your own pace, whether that's just squeezing in single lessons in your lunch breaks, or just trying out everything and taking a dozen classes over a couple of days. And if you have questions, you can talk to your classmates and fellow creatives right there on Skillshare. Now, here's a course to recommend. Plants at Home, Uplift Your Spirit and Your Space by Christopher Griffin. You're probably printing, you know, planter pots and vases anyway, so why not put them to use and actually put the right plants in them? Of course, Skillshare have courses on everything from cooking to CAD, and if you want to try it out, Skillshare are giving away Snamir of premium membership for the first 1,000 people who click the link in the description box below to help you explore your creativity. After that, it is only about 10 bucks a month. Thanks, Skillshare. And thank you all for watching. I'm probably not going to be earning any affiliate commissions from any of you buying the X1, but if you think this video helped you out in any way, you can support the channel just by leaving a like on the video, or even on Patreon or YouTube memberships. I definitely appreciate everyone who's already doing that, because it means I won't need to suck up to the manufacturers of these machines to make producing these reviews worthwhile. Anyways, that's it for today. Keep on making, and I will see you in the next one. Bye.